In Luke chapter 2, verses 41, it reads, "Every year, Jesus' parents, they went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When Jesus was 12 years old, the Bible says they attended the festival as usual. After the celebration was over, they started home to Nazareth. But Jesus, the Bible says, stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents, the Bible says, didn't miss him at first, because they assumed he was among the other travelers. But when he did not show up that evening, because they were accustomed to him showing up, but when he didn't show up, then they grew concerned. They started looking for him among the relatives and friends, among the family and among the acquaintances. When they couldn't find him, it's been a whole day, they didn't recognize that he was gone. After a whole day of not recognizing that Jesus was not among them and that Jesus did not show up as he was accustomed to showing up, then they grew concerned, the Bible says, and they began to search for him. They couldn't find him. And when they could not find Jesus, the Bible says, they decided to go back to Jerusalem. They went back to Jerusalem to search there. Verse 46, 3 days later, they finally discovered Jesus and they found him in the temple. He was in the temple sitting among religious leaders, listening to them and asking questions. All who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. His parents didn't know what to think. "Son," his mother said to him, "why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been frantic. We've been searching for you everywhere. But why did," then he says, "but why? Why did you need to search for me? Didn't you know I must be in my father's house?" And some translation says, "I must be about my father's business." But they didn't understand what he meant. Then he returned to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. And his mother stored all these things in her heart. And all of God's people said together, amen. Amen. For a moment, I just want to share a few words with you, a few minutes, from the subject, finding Jesus. Finding Jesus. We can't quite pick up at verse 41, but I have to kind of lay the foundation for you to understand what is taking place right here by going back a little further. If you understand, the Bible teaches us a few verses before verses 41 that 8 days after Jesus was born, according to the Mosaic law and the custom, when a woman, if her first child is a son, that she had to dedicate him to the Lord. And so Mary's first child happened to be a son. And so therefore she had to dedicate him according to the Mosaic law. She wanted to be obedient. And so they brought him to the temple 8 days after he was born so that he could be dedicated to the Lord. And the Bible says that when Mary and Joseph brought Jesus to the temple to dedicate him to the Lord, there was a man by the name of Simeon there. Simeon was devout. He was righteous. The Bible wants to remind us this. They want us to know this. But Simeon had pleaded with the Lord all his life not to take his life, not to allow him to die until he had a chance to lay eyes and embrace the coming Messiah who would take care of the entire world, who would then make things right. He pleaded to God, and the Bible says that God granted him this prayer. Because one day the Bible said that the Holy Spirit led Simeon to the temple. And the Holy Spirit led him to the temple at the same time that Mary and Joseph was in the temple. And then he laid eyes on Jesus. He grabbed Jesus and he was able to dedicate Jesus back to the Lord. And then he said, "Lord, now you can take me." And he later gives his life. And he got a chance to see the Lord, but he started to talk, the Bible says, in round about verse 33. He started to look at Mary and Joseph, and he started to prophesy about this man, this boy named Jesus, starting to say all kinds of things. And the Bible said in verse 33 that Mary and Joseph were amazed at what they were saying and what he was saying to them about Jesus, about their child. And then while Simeon was prophesying and saying all these kind things and sharing these things about Jesus, and they were amazed. Round about verse 38, a woman by the name of Anna, the Bible says that she was married for 7 years and that her husband died. And after her husband died in 7 years, she just continued to remain in the house of the Lord. She never left the temple. She stayed there all day. She prayed and she fasted every single day. She just stayed there and she celebrated and she praised the Lord every day. But the Bible says that she was now in the temple. Is my microphone on? The Bible says that she was now in the temple, but while she saw Simeon talking to Mary and Joseph, she walked up and she now encountered them talking. And she realized, she recognized that it was Jesus, the Messiah. And the Bible says in verse 38 that when she recognized that it was Jesus, she started to go around the entire church, I mean the temple, telling everybody about Jesus. And the Bible says that Mary and Joseph, they watched and they saw her, that she was telling everybody about the Messiah who is now born, Jesus. But then the Bible says that at that time, that after the dedication was over with, they then left. This was the custom to come to Jerusalem for the Passover feast every year. Once a year, they would come to Jerusalem for this Passover feast. So between verses 39 and 41, about 12 years passes. And so what they teach us when we enter about verse 41, that for 12 years, they've been doing this same routine every year. I imagine they would go to Jerusalem. They would go to the celebration. They would go to the temple and people would start talking about Jesus. Year one, year two, year three, year seven, year 11, year 12. Jesus is now borderline a teenager. He's now a grown man, 13 when he gets 13. But the Bible says that now they're celebrating the Passover as a custom. This is what they normally do. They know how the routine goes. But when the celebration was over, my Bible teaches me, they went back, got into their caravan, and they began to walk back to their home, Nazareth, like they usually do every year. You know the code. You know how we do this. This is our routine. We're familiar with this routine. And they started to walk to Nazareth. But in walking to Nazareth, walking on their way home, Jesus wasn't with them. The Bible says that after the celebration was over, they went to Nazareth. They began to walk home to Nazareth, but Jesus was still in Jerusalem. I'm going to draw the picture. They made plans. Unfortunately, the Lord was still in Jerusalem. Did you know you can make plans and God not be nowhere in them? They made plans. They knew what time they were going to get up. They knew the goals they were going to accomplish, but the Lord wasn't nowhere in them. My Bible teaches me he wasn't with them. He was still in Jerusalem. They had been doing this routine for 12 years. There was never a problem before, but now year 12, the Lord decides he wants to shift. I mean, we've been doing this, Lord. I know how you show up. I know how you move. This thing is familiar to me. They had some great experiences. You know, when we're doing our family reunion, we had some memories. But now the Lord is no is no longer there. One fact remains. The Lord just wasn't with him. And there's nothing worse. Nothing worse than to be stuck somewhere. The Lord used to be. Sometimes you need to learn how to verify your location to make sure the presence of the Lord is still there. Because the presence of the Lord shifted, but they never governed themselves accordingly. Are you functioning in a place where the presence of the Lord is no longer dwelling? Are you operating in a position that the Lord is no longer breathing on? Are you in a relationship? Yeah, I said it. And the presence of the Lord shifted a long time ago. Sometimes you can be stuck somewhere you don't need to be. It's possible, according to this text, to be saved and stuck at the same time. You can know the Lord, but not recognize that the Spirit of the Lord has shifted in your situation. I mean, if Mary and Joseph can mishandle the presence of the Lord, then surely somebody in here can mistake the presence of the Lord being in your situation. I know you made some plans. I know you have some goals. I know there's some things you've been trying to do. But the question is the presence of the Lord in your situation? The real question, or the real statement, is that you can have a Jesus deficiency in your life and not even realize it. They are now in the caravan, and they assumed, according to the King James translation, the King James version, that they supposed he was in the company. And I'm simply saying that you can be without Jesus in somewhere in your life. There can be a Jesus deficiency somewhere and you not even realize it. I'm going to read this. You think your problem is loneliness. I'm making sure I read it. Make sure I say exactly what I want to say. You think your problem is loneliness. Your problem ain't loneliness. Your problem is a Jesus deficiency. I'm going to read again. You think your problem is your insecurities. Your problem is not your insecurities. Your problem is Jesus deficiency. I'm going to keep going. You ain't got to go with me. This is a message I preach to myself by myself. You think your problem is a lack of confidence. Your problem really, those are symptoms. But if you get to the core, if you get to the bottom of what your problem is, it's not the fact that you lack confidence. The problem is there is a Jesus deficiency somewhere in your life and you don't even recognize it. I'm saying they were walking on their way to Nazareth and Jesus was not there and they did not even recognize it. I'm saying your problem isn't your problem. We can trace your problem back somewhere in your life where there is Jesus is not there. It's too much of you and too little of Jesus. Can you identify the place in your life where there is too much of you and too little of Jesus? I'm saying that those are symptoms. We got symptoms and we don't realize that our real problem is the fact that there is not enough. Jesus has shifted and we don't even realize it. Life will confront you and tempt you to misplace Jesus. Your busy schedule will tempt you to misplace Jesus. Your priorities, they will cause you to lose Jesus. What's going on in your life that has caused you to lose Jesus? I'm just walking this thing down. I mean, how could you not know that the Alpha and the Omega is no longer in your presence? How can you not know that the author and the finisher of your faith, the one who created the heavens and the earth, is no longer in your... How can you not recognize that Jesus has shifted in your life and you hadn't even governed yourself accordingly? I'm saying, Mary, Joseph, you're walking and you don't even realize you'd have lost Jesus. How can you lose Jesus is the question. And that's what I come to answer. And then I bid you a good morning. When I'm looking at the text, I'm trying to discover how can we lose Jesus? How can we, Lord, what are you speaking? And it's so simple. I'm going to help you to understand how you may have lost Jesus or how you have the propensity to lose Jesus. I got three of them. Number one, the reason you may have lost Jesus, or the way you will lose Jesus or misplace Jesus, is very simple. Because you're not talking about him. What do you mean you're not talking about him? What do you mean? When you look at verse 33, it's not in your passage. And when you look at verse 38, there's this common motif. When they enter into the temple, Simeon is praising Jesus. Simeon is talking to Mary and Joseph about Jesus. Simeon is sharing with others about Jesus. And Anna, when Anna comes to the scene, she begins to praise Jesus. She begins to talk about Jesus to Mary and Joseph and to everyone else in the temple. They had grown accustomed to other people talking about Jesus. They grew accustomed to being observers of other people witnessing Jesus, that they never opened their mouths. And I'm saying you can lose Jesus when you're not talking about him. I'm not trying to propose to you that they were not excited about Jesus. I'm just simply saying that it comes a point in your life where you have to move from the passenger seat to the driver's seat about your testimony. There comes a point in your life where you no longer be an observer, but now you have to be a participator about your faith. I'm saying there comes a point in your life where you can no longer settle listening to other people talk about Jesus while you just keep your mouth closed. The reason why you lose Jesus is because you're not talking about him. I'm looking at the text, and they're just keeping their mouth closed, and they're accustomed to other people talking about Jesus, talking about the faith, and talking about what God is doing and who Jesus is. But at some point in time, you got to start talking about Jesus. And the reason why you lost him is because you're not talking about him. You can't activate your gifts. Other people can talk about your gifts and talents all day, but until you start talking about them, they won't be activated. I'm saying you'll lose what you're not talking about. You need to talk about Jesus. I'm not saying everything come out your mouth got to be Jesus, but I am saying that if you want to know how you lost Jesus or how you will misplace Jesus, it's because you're not talking about him enough. Mary, Joseph, I know that's your child, but I need you to talk about him. Year one, year two, year five, year 10, year 12, and they're just accustomed to other people praising Jesus and talking about Jesus, but it's time for you to open your mouth. It's time for you to start talking about Jesus. It's time for you to start sharpening your witness. You have to shift from just being a spectator, an observer, and now, look, I need to tell you who the Lord is to me. This is who Jesus is. This is what the Lord has done to my life. You will lose Jesus if you're not talking about him. We keep looking. And the second thing is a reason why you will lose Jesus is because you've allowed comfort and convenience to extinguish your excitement. You've allowed comfort and convenience to extinguish your excitement. You've allowed convenience to rob you. You've allowed comfort to rob you. Yes, I know who Jesus is. This is what we do year after year. Yeah, I know how the Lord moves. He's available. He's always accessible to me. He's always available to me. So it's nothing new. I'm just saying they assumed that Jesus was among them. They assumed that Jesus was among them. So it was, now Jesus is no longer among you, but they've grown so convenient. Sometimes that's why God has to grow quiet. In your life, sometimes God grows quiet because it wasn't until he did not show up that they started to search for him. It wasn't until he didn't show up as they expected that then they triggered to them that something, the Lord ain't moving like he used to move. The Lord is a little quiet now, so now I need to pray a little harder. Now I got to start seeking the Lord. Now I'm energized all over again. I'm saying they're grown so comfortable and familiar. Familiarity will ruin you. Familiarity will cause you to overlook the details. Familiarity will breed complacency. The Bible said that it wasn't until they recognized that Jesus did not show up. We have a tendency of responding to the Lord when he doesn't show up the way we expect him to. We have a tendency to get up and start praying more because now the Lord is a little quiet and we need something from him. They grew so comfortable. It was so convenient because Jesus was accessible that they allowed space to become in between them. I'm supposed to share with you that familiarity is the first cousin of assumption. Because familiarity breeds contentment. Contentment gives birth to negligence. Negligence is a thief of fulfillment. Familiarity breeds contentment. Contentment gives birth to negligence. And negligence, it's the thief of fulfillment. They grew too familiar with their route home. They grew too familiar with knowing Jesus was right. Everything was familiar to them, and familiarity will lull your senses to sleep. And this is why sometimes God has to grow quiet, God has to shift, God has to move, because your senses have been lulled to sleep and you're just taking every day the business as usual. They left the celebration and went back to business as usual. And that's why sometimes God needs to shift in our lives, because we've been living business as usual for too long. They misplaced Jesus because convenience and comfort extinguished their excitement. And the last thing is this. It's very simple. It's very simple. The reason why, or the way you may lose Jesus or misplace Jesus, is because there is a gap in your life that you're not addressing. What are you saying? There's a gap in your life that you're not addressing. This is what the Bible says. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, King James Version, went an entire day's journey, and they sought him among kinsfolk, among family, and acquaintances, their friends. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem. The Bible says they assumed that he was in the company, that he was among the travelers. Come here. I need you to come here. I'm talking to you. You. Yeah, come on. Yeah. Keisha, come here. Come here, Keisha. Thank you. I appreciate it. He was just staring at me. The Bible says that they were traveling home to Nazareth, right? And they assumed, I need a Jesus. Can you be Jesus for me? Come on. Be Jesus for me. Come on, brother. We're going to keep this thing diverse. That's what we're going to do. Come on. All right. I'm the parents. This is Jesus. The Bible says that they were on their way to Nazareth when the celebration was over with, right? And the Bible says that they assumed that Jesus was among the family and the friends, among the acquaintances, among your loved ones. I need you to be Jesus, and I need you to come over here and turn around, right? Turn around to the people, right? I didn't think this through, but that's Jesus, right? And this is the caravan, and we're on our way home. But I assumed that Jesus was among my family and my friends, right? Jesus, you stay right there. Y'all stay where y'all at. Follow me. We're in the temple celebrating. But the Bible says when the celebration was over, we were on our way home. And then now we're on our way home. The Bible says, y'all stay where y'all at. Y'all getting ahead of me. The Bible says that they assumed that Jesus was among the friends and the family. I need you to come over here. And so now there is a growing gap between me and Jesus. And they assumed that Jesus was among the friends and the family. And then now I need somebody else just to come up here. Just anybody, just one person. Just come on. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Come on up here. Because there is a gap. Come on. Yeah. There is a gap. And there are some things and there are some people that are filling the gap. They assume that Jesus was among the friends and the family. And so now I got people that are standing in between me and Jesus. I got things standing in the gap between me and Jesus. I need somebody else to come up here because the truth of the matter is the reason why you truly lost Jesus or the reason why you misplaced Jesus is because you're giving out the prime real estate to the wrong people. There is a gap in between me and Jesus. And I'm saying that they're filled with somebody you love. They're filled with some issues that you have. There is a gap and Jesus is over there, but Jesus is supposed to be next to me because the Bible said that when we were in the temple, he was right here. But when I left the temple, then all of a sudden things and people started to come between me because he's among the people. He's among my friends. I'm saying, who have you elevated in your life and given the prime real estate that is now taking space that they should not be taking? What issue do you have in your life that you're beginning to idolize that is standing in between the gap between you and Jesus? I'm saying, I need somebody else. Somebody else can come up here because there is a gap. I know you're laughing at me, but I need somebody to come up here because you have a gap between you and Jesus. You got too many people. You got too many issues that you're allowing these people to come in between you and Jesus. And more people just keep on coming because there is a gap that you are allowing between you and Jesus after the celebration was over. Because I got to draw the picture. There's a celebration. We're in the temple. We're celebrating the Lord. We're celebrating. But when we left the temple, then all of a sudden, I know I love her and I want her to be mine. I know it's not working out, but she's in my gap now. And I got my partner, I appreciate that because she's my partner. And yeah, I know. And I got some issues on my job. It's in the gap now. I got some issues that I'm thinking about, some insecurities. And so I just put it in the gap. And so before you know it, Jesus is not even anywhere to be found because I got too many people and too many things in the gap. I'm saying you got a gap in your life and it's keeping you from being able to communicate with Jesus. And the problem is you don't even recognize it. They are now walking and there is a growing gap in between them and Jesus. And the Bible said they didn't even recognize it at first. A whole day went by. And I hadn't even recognized that Jesus is not even among me. The Holy Spirit has shifted and I'm going business as usual. I got too many people in my gap. I got too many things in the gap between me and Jesus. And I need to start releasing some people. Or even if it doesn't mean releasing people, you need to put them in their proper role. I love you. I'm not going to dismiss you. But you can't be in between me and Jesus, right? So I need to put you in the right position. There you go. go on. I love you. I appreciate you. I know that I need to help you, but I cannot help you if I have a gap between me and Jesus, right? Because then I'm now, it's codependent. I gotta put you in the right position. I love you. I can help you, but I can't have a gap in between you and Jesus. I got some issues, right? Nobody knows. Because see, the thing about it, nobody can see your gap. You've been hiding your gap. That's good. Nobody can see it. You probably lie to yourself to act like it's not there, but you got a gap. We got a gap. And I'm saying, listen. The only way I'm going to get rid of, I need to walk in my calling. And the only way I'm going to be able to walk in my calling, I need to close the gap. And I just need to put you in the right position. I know I don't believe I have what it takes to do what God has called me to do, but I'm just going to believe it today. And people been speaking to me, I'm going to walk in it, but I don't have the confidence, but I'm going to walk in it today. Come on. I'm just saying, I appreciate everything you've done for me, but there is a gap. I can't grow complacent. Oh, I can see the Lord now. He's at a distance. So if I need him, I could just reach out to him. No. There's still a gap in between me and the Lord. And you two people, I love you to death, but I gotta reposition you. I gotta reposition you because the Bible says that they were in the temple. And because they were in the temple, that means that they were celebrating and Jesus was there. But just because you leave the temple doesn't mean you got to create a gap in between you and Jesus. You can. Thank you, Jesus. I appreciate it. But hold on. You're going to miss something. Well, how do I keep from misplacing Jesus? I know you told me how I do misplace Jesus, but how do I keep from misplacing Jesus? You ask great questions. It's very simple. The Bible says what? The Bible says that when the celebration was over, comma, they went to Nazareth. Somebody gonna catch it. The Bible said when the celebration was over, they went to Nazareth. And that's when they lost Jesus. All right, we're going to try it right again. When the celebration was over, comma, they lost Jesus. When the celebration was over, comma, they lost Jesus. If you want to keep from losing Jesus, don't stop the celebration. Don't stop the celebration. I'm talking about when you get up in the morning, you need to learn to celebrate what the Lord has done for you. Just because you're no longer at the church doesn't mean you have to stop the celebration, because get this, what you don't celebrate will eventually shrink in your life. It will shrink because of the lack of affirmation and attention you give to it. And until you learn how to celebrate the Lord in the morning, celebrate the Lord throughout the day, and celebrate the Lord in the evening, you will eventually lose him. You will lose your excitement. I know you were excited last week, but you're no longer excited now. Why? Because you stopped celebrating. You can't just wait until Sunday to start celebrating. You got to celebrate Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, until you learn how to celebrate every day. You will eventually lose Jesus. The entire day had gone by, but we were accustomed. We were caught in our routine. We celebrated the Lord, and then we left the temple. And then when we left the temple, that's when the celebration stopped. And I'm saying too many of us, we're just celebrating when we get to the temple, but we don't celebrate when we get home. And until you learn how to celebrate throughout the day, every day, you will eventually misplace Jesus. Because get this, the Bible says a statement that is very essential. Man, I gotta go. I'm sorry, y'all. The Bible says this. They didn't immediately realize that Jesus was gone, right? Because when you lose your faith, when you lose your passion, when you lose your excitement, it doesn't happen immediately. it happens gradually. When you stop celebrating, you begin to lose things gradually, not immediately. And the last thing I'm supposed to tell you, I'm over time, and I apologize, is this. If you want to keep from misplacing Jesus, don't leave him in the temple. Just that simple. Don't leave Jesus at church. Too many of us, we just come to church to see Jesus, encounter Jesus, and we leave Jesus at the church. If you want to keep from misplacing Jesus, you want to keep from losing Jesus, stop leaving him at church. Because when you look at verse 33 and you look at verse 38, when you see the encounter with Simeon, when you see the encounter with Anna, guess what? It happened at the designated place in the temple. Everything that took place, it took place in the temple. They didn't lose. Jesus didn't go anywhere. Jesus was at the same place he was all the time, because the Lord never changes. They found Jesus where they left him. They found Jesus at the same place they left him. He didn't go anywhere. He didn't leave. He was at the same place you left him. He's at the church. Because that's the only time you give him your undivided attention, at church. That's the only time you give him 30 good minutes before you say it's time to go give me some. I'm saying you need to take him. You don't go grocery shopping and leave all your groceries at the store. I'm saying, why you go grocery shopping and get all the stuff you want and just gonna bag all your items and just gonna leave it there? Because that's what you do now. You don't do that when you go grocery shopping. You don't need to do that when you come to church. Lord, we thank you for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt. Lord, bless us today. Keep us from losing you. Keep us from losing our luster. Keep us from losing our excitement. Keep us from allowing people to come between us. I don't care who it is, Lord. Reveal to us our gap. And reveal to us the things and the people who are in the gap in between you and me. Lord, we love you. And I'm praying right now that someone under the sound of my voice has not had an encounter with you. They don't know who you are and the pardon of their sins. And Lord, right now, I am praying for their life, for their spirit right now, Lord. They will say, I want to be saved. I want to find Jesus. I don't ever want to lose him. So Lord, we thank you for never changing. We thank you for your love and your kindness in Jesus' name. Amen.